Very good morning, one and all present over here. So here we're going to discuss about the fundamental principles of gas chromatography. So basically, gas chromatography is a technique which is used to separate two or more components. If a mixture has multiple number of components, we need to separate it. For that, we can use chromatography. So chromatography was initially written, or the name was coined by a botanist, Russian botanist, Michael Tesfut in 1903. Actually, his research paper was about to produce colorful separation of plant pigments through a column of calcium carbonate. So for that, he used this technique of chromatography. So chromatography essentially means writing with colors. Chromo means color. Graph means to write or record. So he got a Nobel Prize for this work. Followed by Tesfut, many people have explored this field of chromatography. In 1915, R.M. Wilslater, a German scientist, won a Nobel Prize for a similar experiment. In 1922, L.S. Palmer is also an American scientist, used the Tesfut techniques on various natural products. In 1931, Richard Kuhn used chromatography to separate isomers. Then we have different other people. 1938, thin layer chromatography came into picture. 1941, liquid-liquid partition chromatography. 1944, paper chromatography. And the first GC was developed by Fritz Prayer in 1945. These are some of the people who pioneered the field of this chromatography. So now our interest is gas chromatography. So it has developed into an invaluable tool for separation and identification of compounds. If you have a very composite mixture, when you want to separate into individual, then for that case, we can use gas chromatography. So no longer the color plays a very important role, but still the name is followed as such. So before we get into the broad spectrum of gas chromatographies, there are some basic terms we have to understand. First thing, you have a column. Column is something, as the name insists, a small passage. Okay, so the column is fixed. The column is fixed, so you call it as stationary phase. So the name is called as stationary phase. Through this column, the sample with the solvent enters and goes out. Okay, so the solvent moving through the column, you call it as mobile phase. So you have two entities. One is a stationary phase. Second one is moving phase, mobile phase. Stationary phase is the column fixed. Through that, a liquid or something that moves is called as mobile phase. So when the fluid is entering the column, you call it as eluent. When the fluid moves out, you call it as eluate. That's all. Now, gas chromatography is as simple as if your mobile phase is going to be a gas carrier, then it's called gas chromatography. If your mobile phase is liquid, you call it as liquid chromatography. This is the basic idea of how a chromatographic column looks like. Now, so this is a broad classification of chromatography. Here you can see the classification is based on the nature of mobile phase. That's what we have seen, liquid, gas, or supercritical fluid, or the nature of the support. So it can be a 2D or 3D support. Or the type of separation mechanism. It can be based on adsorption, partition, ion exchange. Okay, so a good number of mechanisms have developed over time. So now we'll be concentrating on gas chromatography. So what is gas chromatography? It's a technique in which separation is accomplished by partitioning a substance between a mobile carrier phase and a stationary phase. So here, what do you mean by gas? Essentially, when you read this term gas chromatography, gas essentially means the mobile phase is gas. That's all. That's as simple as it is. The separation is done in a column which is kept in your oven. So what is the significance of oven? We'll see it in due time. So basic idea how this gas chromatography works. Here you can see an example, we'll take it. It's like that train full of zoo animals is moving. Suddenly there was a sudden breakage due to some unknown factors. The train breaks and all the animals inside that particular railway rail gets derailed, gets into that small river. So here you can see three animals alone we have taken into picture here. There are some elephants, there are some cows, there are some monkeys. So three animals, they are mixed group of three animals. One is elephant, second one is a cow, third one is monkeys. So we have a mixed group of these three. Now we need to separate this, okay? So this you can visualize, this is your sample. The sample is nothing but mixture of elephants, monkeys and cows. The river is like the mobile face. It is the one which is carrying them. The river is like the mobile face. You have the mixture is being carried through the mobile face. Clear? Now, we'll move them to a stationary face. You remember the column I told you. You have a column which is a stationary face. Similarly, here you have a stationary face. We move all this to an island. In this island, what very peculiar thing is, on one end of the island, you have arranged bananas. One end, you have arranged grass. One end, you have arranged peanuts. So what happens? Naturally, where you have the peanuts, all the elephants move towards the peanuts. Where you have the grass, all the cow will move towards the grass. Where you have the bananas, all the monkeys will move towards the bananas. So this is the idea. We need to separate them. So in the island, we have different regions with different items concentrated in each region. So each particular thing will go into that particular region and they start to eat. So whichever eats first will come out, then followed by the second, then third. For example, in this case, say elephants finish eating the peanuts fast. So they come out first. So you'll have a bridge crossing that river. So there will be a person will be there to count whether they have got all the people back. So first, the elephants come, she counts the elephants, three elephants, okay, done, gone. Then monkeys spend some more time, and after that monkeys come, you know that cows will take more time to eat the grass. So second, the monkeys come after eating the bananas, so we count the monkeys. Third, the cows come, okay. So you can visualize what is happening here. So you got initially a mixture of three animals which were in the river, which are carried by the river. So it is like a sample of having more than two mixtures which has been contained in a mobile phase. You make it flow through a stationary phase. The stationary phase here is island. In the island, you have different foods concentrated in each region. So each animal will try to move to their particular place and they start eating the food. Once they eat the food, whichever eat first, it will come out. Okay, so you have a column. You move the sample into the column. There is some mechanism that will take place. Thereby, all the materials, all the sample elements will get attached to the column temporarily, like the animals which ate the food. Once the time is over, the component which is having least affinity will come out first. Like the elephants here the affinity factor is connected with whoever is eating first. So here the elephants ate first, so they came out. Second, the monkeys. Third, the cow. Similarly, the compound which has least affinity to the column will come out first. Most affinity will take more time to come. So medium affinity will slowly move. Okay, so this is the idea. So this is the idea of separating a mixture. So at last you get a count. So this count will tell you how many bananas, how many monkeys are there, how many elephants are there, and how many cows are there. Okay, so this recording is called as a chromatogram. This recording is called chromatogram. Now, the separation actually takes place with respect to time. So whichever is finishing fast, it will come out first. Similarly, which is having less affinity will come out first. More affinity will take more time. Okay. So the affinity, the factor here we are connected is, it's by a factor called adsorption. So when you pass a material through it, what actually happens in the column is the elements or the substances in the mobile phase get adsorbed to the surface. Whichever is least adsorbed will come out first. Whichever is more absorbed, it will take more time to come. Using this concept of adsorption only, we are trying to classify the different mixture elements. So the instrumentation system for gas chromatography looks simple, as simple as that is. So fundamentally, you require a gas source to carry the sample mixture. So you have a gas source here. This is a gas source. Then you have an inlet where you inject the sample. So the gas source, essentially, as the name indicates, it's a mobile phase. It carries a sample. Then it carries a sample through the column. So column here is the stationary phase, where with time, the separation of the components occurs. And finally, as each component come out, they are detected with the help of a detector. And you do the data interpretation. And from that, you identify what is the component that is present in the mixture. This is a basic idea of an instrumentation system. So this is your detailed block diagram. So here you have the carrier gas. You need to regulate the flow. So this is a sample. So where you have a column, the column is in the form of coils. Okay, here you inject the sample. So the gaseous carries your sample. It moves. And you can see a very important thing here. It is called as O1. So the purpose of the O1 is very, very important, because you have to do it in an environment which is controlled with temperature. So there is something that is happening that is having related with temperature. So we have been telling about a phenomenon called adsorption. So adsorption is somewhat related to temperature. So we'll be seeing it. So finally, you have a detector and it goes for the computer analysis. These are the types of carrier gases that are used. Nitrogen, it is cheap, safe, and easy purification, but it takes very long time to go throughout the column. Whereas hydrogen or helium, they have very less time. Okay, but it's quite expensive. And hydrogen, it can react with several compounds. Okay, so it may be explosive. Okay, so they have a lot of constraints. So depending upon the requirements, we can choose the type of carrier gas. So how the column works? Basically, the column is a material which is constructed using stainless steel or fused silica Teflon. It is a coil having 10 to 30 centimeter dia. So it is housed in your oven, and it is normally winded. Fine. Okay. So this is how a typical column looks like. So how the separation works on the column. So we'll see an animated view of what happens. So this is your column. So the column end, you have the detector. Fine. Now this column is coated with a material. It's coated with a material. So you have two types of columns. One is a packed one, another one is a coated column. For example, we'll show it like it's filled with, but we'll show it like it is coated. So it is coated with dimetaqueous earth, a material. Okay. So this is a material. This tube with the dimetaqueous earth forms a stationary phase. Now we'll introduce the mixture. Once the mixture comes inside, it tries to adsorb to the surface. The sample, you can see, the sample comes and it adsorbs to the surface. Here, blue is less adsorbed, so it has moved a bit large. Whereas the red is most adsorbed, it takes more time to move. Your yellow is medium in between these two, so it is in center. So the information is, here blue is having less affinity or less adsorption, so it has moved. Okay, so if you allow for some more time, the blue gradually move down, whereas the yellow, which is having the red has the least maximum absorption, so it will be clinging to the surface. It will take more time to come. Okay, here we have the critical factor called temperature. So as the temperature increases, an interesting thing happens, the adsorption decreases. As temperature increases, adsorption decreases. What will happen if adsorption decreases? Adsorption is the one which is helping those molecules to attach to the surface. So as you increase the temperature gradually, those adsorption will decrease and slowly the movement will be accelerated. For example, in this case, if I increase the temperature, you can see it moves out. Okay, so this is the idea. So you move inside, with time the adsorption slowly takes place. Increase the temperature gradually so that one by one each component comes out. So at the detector, you detect the compound. So first blue comes out, then yellow, then red. So count. And this is the time that is taken. The time is called as retention time. That depends upon the adsorption. If a component is more adsorbed, it will have more retention time. If a component is less adsorbed, it has less retention time. So the key factor is adsorption decreases when temperature rises. Okay, this is a fundamental thing that is used for separating the compounds. So there are a good number of detectors that are available for separating. So these are some of the detectors: flame ionization detector, thermal conductivity detector, electron capture, and of course mass chromatography is another excellent technique. Normally if you see, GC is coupled with mass chromatography. GC-MS is a very famous material type of thing. So application, it is used for bacterial identification, environmental analysis, water analysis, air analysis, clinical and toxicology analysis, forensic technology. So we have discussed only the basic principles of gas chromatography. Thank you.